All stand, please. We have in Jesus in your bulletin as she plays. We're not going to sing it, but that is what she's playing right now. Friend we have in Jesus, and what a friend we come here to bless her homegoing and to renew our hearts and to comfort our hearts in her loss. But our loss is the Lord's gain. But I just want to thank you, each person who have ministered this family across the time. Her last year, season of her life, I call it. And let us go to God in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love and care for Zettie. We thank you for your everlasting love and mercy. We turn to you because you know us, and we are in your deep, loving care. We are bound to you on every side. How completely we depend on your loving mercy and kindness. You know all things and all of our failings, all our needs, all our sorrows and griefs. Without you, Lord, we are poor and weak, and with you, Lord, we are able to be brave and strong in your hands. You are like a loving God to us, brooding over us in your presence. In death and life and sorrow and in joy, you, Lord, are waiting to bless us with your love and forgiveness. We turn to you in this strong name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. The hymn that the family has chosen is Amazing Grace, and my Penrod will listen to that right now.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first
Amazing Grace is the one recorded song across the world, sung more than any other piece of gospel music there is. Amazing Grace is that one. And it's amazing how God loves us. It's amazing that He loves us even when He knows us as well as He does. But I am here today to help you get excited for Zettie. I want you to be excited. When you leave here, I don't want you to be down in the dumps. I want you to be up, because she, by faith, accepted Christ in May of 1954, a year after I was born. When I was a baby, she was accepting Christ. And for all these years, she's been serving God. Is Zettie perfect? No, indeed. Is Zettie a saint in that regard? I don't think so, but she is, and many attributes of her were about her love for God manifest through her flesh and her walk. And we grieve today, not because she's gone. We grieve because we're going to miss her. We grieve because we know it's gone. You know, it was said one time before that when we go, we're no longer, don't believe the obituary. She did not pass. She may have entered heaven, but she did not pass away. She became more alive, more mobile, with a wonderful spirit, and a great person. She was able to live in the very presence of God. And I know that those in her family that know Jesus, they must be having a shouting time with her and laughing and talking and being real close to what the Lord would have us to do. This morning, I want us to look at a verse of Scripture, a couple of verses of Scripture. And when we look at these Scriptures, we have to realize that God is in the business of loving us, and He's in the business of taking care of us. And when we as Christians realize that, we realize that He really wants the very best for us. And I want to read from Ecclesiastes. It's on the back of your bulletin. It says, "There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to uproot. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to tear down, a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones and a time to gather them. A time to embrace and a time to refrain. A time to search and a time to give up. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to mend. A time to be silent, a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time for war and a time for peace. What does the worker gain from his toil? I have seen," the writer goes, "I have seen the burden of God laid on men. He has made everything beautiful in its time." I believe the Beatles or pop group used to make that. I think it was the Beatles. "He has also set eternity in their hearts." I like that phrase right there. If you don't have Christ, there's a part of your life that is missing and cannot be filled up with money, relationships, and everything else under the sun. The only thing that will make that part of your heart complete is God coming into your life. "He has made everything beautiful in this time. Yea, they cannot fathom what God has done from beginning to end. I know that everything God does will endure forever. Nothing can be added to it, and nothing be taken away. God does it that men will revere Him, and whatever has already been and what will be has been before. And God will call the past to account. And I saw something under the sun, a place for judgment. Wickedness was there, and a place for justice, and wickedness was there. And I thought in my heart, God will bring judgment both to the righteous and the wicked, for there will be a time for every activity, a time for every deed." Ecclesiastes chapter 3. When we look at that verse of Scripture, it leads me to my next passage of Scripture and from the Old Testament, and it goes like this. It's in Psalms 90. "Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, from ever, forever, you have formed the earth and the world. Even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. You turn man to destruction and say, oh, return, children of men. For a thousand," I like this verse of Scripture, "for a thousand years in your sight, Lord, is like yesterday when it is past. It is like a watch in the night." 88 years, a long time. We think, well, that's a good life. But let me tell you what, if Zettie was here, she'd tell you make every day count, every minute count, make something count every day. Because it's going to be soon to be over with. "You carry them away like a flood. They are like sheep. In the morning, they are like grass, which groweth up. And in the morning, it flourishes and grows up. In the evening, it's cut down and withers. For we have consumed by your anger, and by your wrath, we are terrified. Who have set our iniquities before us, our secret sins in the light of your countenance? For all our days are passed away in your wrath. We finish our years like a sigh. The days of our lives are 70 years. And if by reason of strength, they are 80 years. And we know she went on beyond that. Yet your boast is only labor and sorrow, for it is soon cut off and we fly away. Who knows the power of your anger? For the fear of you is your wrath. And when we realize that, we realize that as Christians, and he says, so teach us to number our days that we may gain wisdom in the heart. In other words, the best thing we can do as parents is teach our family and our kids and our young people in our family that today is today. You got to do what you got to do today and do it well. And that is very, very important for us to understand and to do. One of the things that we have here for the next song is Great Are You, Lord. Listen to the words as the CD is being played.
Shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Oh,
is so true. That song talks about God pouring out his grace on us, and he sure did that with Zettie. And she acknowledged that, and she poured a lot of grace into a lot of people's lives. One of the things that we must realize is that Zettie was so unique. She reminded me of one other person I know in size, demeanor, hair, and her voice. She was pointed. When she had something to say to you, she would say it. And she didn't care if you liked it or not. And she was full of grace. She loved people. She liked helping people. She had a heart full of compassion. And not to know Grace, not to know Zettie, you cheated yourself out of a good memory, because she was a sweetheart. And but she was strict. And whenever I went to her, I always hugged her. And I said, "You remind me so much of my mama." So really, God, when he makes one good person, he makes a copy of it so somebody else can enjoy it too, is by what I understand. But she has been a strong person. She was a member at Riverdale Baptist Church when I was her pastor there. And she loved the Lord, and she couldn't get around like other people were, but she had a good way about her. I want to read from the New Testament. Bear with me as I read the scripture. It's about 16 verses. In 1 John 4, it says, "You are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. They are of the world, therefore they speak as the world. The world hears them. Ye are of God, and he knows who God hears. He who is not of God does not hear us. By this we know the spirit of truth, the spirit of error. Beloved, let us love one another," is what John writes. "For love is of God. For everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. And he that does not have love does not know God, and is, for God is love. In this we love God, was manifest toward us, that God sent his only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through him." And I always kind of use the word conduit. If it's a conduit, where the wires go inside of it. We live in Christ, and he works through us and in us. And he loved us and his Son for the sins of the world. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought to love one another. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love is made perfect or complete in us. By this we know that we are abiding in him, and he is in us, because he has given to us his Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent the Son as Savior of the world. And whosoever confesses Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him and he in God. And we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and he who abides in love abides in God and God in him. Love is made complete or perfect among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment, and he who fears is not made complete in love. We love him because he first loved us. I love that verse of scripture. If someone says, "I love God," and hates his brother, he is a liar. For he who does not love his brother, whom he has seen, tell me, how can he love God whom he has not seen? And this is the commandment that we have of him, that he who loves God must love his brother also. Wow. When we see this, we realize that this scripture is always able. It's always relevant. It's already, all of us have been hurt by somebody. All of us have endured some daggers to our heart. We've endured the cold shoulder and all, everything else. But the Bible says that if you're in God, you must love your brother. And that's not an option. He says he didn't use the wrong terminology in the Greek. It says you must love your brother. That doesn't mean that you got to like all the things they do. Now, I love my kids, but I don't agree with a lot of things they do. I'm not going to do that. But I'm going to love them. And somebody is mean to me and unkind to me, you want to tell them? I said, I love you with mature love. I don't like you, but I love you with mature love. That means I got to love you. I'm going to love you regardless. You can be on the other side of the fence. It don't make a difference to me. I'm going to love you. And you can't get away from that. And you can't fight love. Anybody who fights love is really fighting a losing battle. She was a type of person that she not only was faithful to her Lord. And by the way, some people think that faithfulness to the Lord is always attending church. Don't get me wrong. That's important. But when the winter season comes in your life, a lot of things you have to put down you can't do like you used to do. And that's just the way it is. I don't like my age, matter of fact. I detest it. I wish my wife would let me dye my hair black, but she won't. And all my beauticians, they won't do anything to my hair until they talk to Carolyn. So you ladies have got it made. Got it made. We control like that. But I'll tell you what. Being generous and good in all things. What did Mom say years ago? What did she tell you? If you can't say anything good, don't say nothing at all. And sometimes, don't you wish somebody just shut up? That's what I do. I don't tell them that. That's rude to tell somebody that. But if I have a close friend that we jovial back and forth, I tell them, well, why don't you just shut up? Just leave me alone, you know. But we don't do that in casual relationships. But Jesus tells us that if we're going to be the people that we need to be, not only should we believe in our heart and confess. Now, Zettie don't need faith anymore. You know why? She's already got it. You don't need faith in heaven. Faith is something you exercise and what you're not seeing, something you've not seen. She's seeing the glory of God. So she don't need faith anymore. And a lot of times, she don't need the hope anymore. She don't need the hope anymore because all of her hope has come to fruition. It's all there in front of her. And the point is that love abides. Love is an everlasting part of our lives as Christians that ought to mark us. Being good, that's good, but not always good. Jesus knows how bad you are. He knows how frail you are. He knows how things, what you say in to yourself in a closet. He knows exactly what's going on. But God loves us, and he loves Zettie. And the thing about Zettie, she loved people. She liked people. She loved people. And she flat out tell you some things. If you stayed there long enough with a close friend, she'd tell you what she thought of something. And when I was her pastor, she told me a few things. And I didn't want to admit to it, but she was right. I didn't tell her she was right, because that'd give her more strength and give me more criticism. But I didn't mess with about that. But this is the thing, that if we're going to be the people that we need to be at the end of life, after the end of 3 score years, 4 score years, 80 plus, everything you may have doesn't matter. Everything you accomplish doesn't matter. All your education doesn't matter because you're in heaven. And matter of fact, I'll tell you something. Only smart people get there, smart enough to accept Christ. And they may be dumb as a clam on this side of heaven, but I'll tell you, smart people accept Christ and follow him. And they enjoy that. And so as we live for God and we let Jesus become the centerpiece of our life, you too can live a life where at the end it may be said of you that you were a person of love. It didn't mean you loved everything you seen. Didn't mean you loved everything everybody said. I have a hard time keeping my mouth shut. I know you have a hard time believing that. but I have a real hard time keeping my mouth shut. And my wife, whenever she's around me, she reminds me to shut it up. She does. David? And I could be in service, and I see her out there, and she said, and I was, I'm running down the wrong path. My wife just closed her eyes a little bit and just do this here, just a little teeny nod this way. And she very seldom ever does this. Yeah, go, preacher, go. She doesn't want to say that very often. But she does give me some instruction. And Zeddy's life can be a path that we can follow the footsteps. Listen, did she have mountains? Yes. Did she have valleys? Yes. Did she lose a lot? Yes, she loved a lot and lost a lot. All of us do. I'm part of Weight Watchers. I know you can't tell it, but they got the highs, the lows, everything else. And the thing is, over and over again, they can tell whether, you know, I'm on key or not. They can tell. They can look at me. I come in the door, and they can look at me. I don't like that. And matter of fact, I haven't been since the virus just done broke out. I don't need that criticism. I ain't going. But the thing is, as a Christian, we as God's children need to love one another. Listen, if you don't love your own folks, if you don't love your own family, if you don't love your own people that be around your own friends, if you can't love them, who can you love? A stranger? I don't think so. I don't think so. When we do that, we realize that God wants us to love people. And the hallmark in the Christian faith across the years, when the disciples didn't have a Bible, all they had was Jesus' words in their head and what they remembered him saying. The hallmark of a Christian was, does he love people? Now, it wasn't whether you're Jewish, it wasn't whether you were from Israel or Greece or Africa or Ethiopia. It didn't make a difference. Any of that stuff didn't matter. The only thing that marked the Christians in that day and time was their love for one another. You know what that means? You need to cut back on the criticism when you're talking about a brother in Christ. Now, if your husband and wife, you open up and just go at it. I don't care. But with other people you don't have a real strong relationship with, guess what? You need to be careful what you say and love people. And I took a vow about a couple years ago after somebody's funeral that I would never bring up the past to my sons. God, that's been hard. I wrote him a letter and signed it and sealed it in blood. I'm not going to remind you of anything you've done wrong. And I can tell you a thousand things they've done wrong. I will encourage you, and I will give you advice only when you ask for it. That is so hard for this preacher to do. I want to give people advice all the time. But Zettie was like that. She was like that a great deal. And I can't imagine her working at ITT for 30 years. Don't you know that she gave the union guy a run for his money? I don't know who he was. I know one of the union guys used to work out there, Red Adams. But don't you know she didn't let nobody run over her. If you did, you had to have a big tractor to get it. I mean, it had to be a strong vehicle to run over her. But the thing was that as Christians, we need to pray for strength to carry on. And we need to pray for yourself to change, and that is what is positive. We need to pray for your family first and then others. Because if you can't pray for your own family, who in the world can you pray for? My little grandson lives with us. His name is Asher. And he said, "You coming to chapel today, Dad?" I said, "I hadn't thought about it." And at private school, and I said, "Well, what are you doing?" He said, "I'm praying." I said, "I'll be there." I was there. I was so proud of him. I had peacock feathers that rised up behind me that I didn't even know I had. I was so proud of it. And he prayed this basic same prayer he does at the table when he asks the blessing. Thank you for shelter, God. Thank you for Mom. Thank you for Dad. Thank you for food. Thank you for clothes. And he did the same thing there. He did the same thing there. I was so proud of him. Proud of it. But we teach by our love. And the bad thing is, the negative thing, sometimes we teach by our unloving things we say and do. But I loved Zettie. Zettie was a good soul. She was an old-fashioned girl. She'd tell you what things are right and not right. her brothers, I know, when those that were living when I was closer on a cliff, they come to her and they talk about wonderful things that brothers talk about. And the things when you get older, that this is what happens when you get older. You don't talk about nonsense anymore. You talk about real issues, real issues. Why do you want to waste your breath on talking about nonsense when you get older? We talk about real issues. The issue is this today. If you've never accepted Christ, I encourage you to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord. Confess him as your Lord and Savior. Say a prayer or something like this. Lord, I know that I've sinned, and I know I've hurt your feelings, and I know that you sent Jesus to live on this world, and he died on a cross to take my sins away. He laid in a grave for 3 days and came back up, and he's going to come back again. I believe in Jesus. I believe in Jesus. Jesus is not a ghost. He's not a figment of your imagination, as philosophy would have you to know. But he is a real person, and I'm looking forward to seeing that real person. I haven't seen him, because when I see him, I'll be in heaven. I haven't seen him yet. I ain't there yet. And the thing is, as Christians and as young people, especially Brooke and Morgan, that the more that you talk about Zettie and how she was, and talk about good things about her brownie, her fur brownie, you know, talk about that, and love on that, and just talk about how she loves you, and funny little things, and because that will get you to the next point. The next point is the day when you make bigger decisions than you are right now, and one of those decisions is really putting God first in your life. I will miss Zettie. I will miss her. I miss her hugs. I miss her voice. I miss looking at her hair. And I look at a mess. She lived there in Southeast, and house looked like a diamond house in the middle of whatever. Because Brian fixed it up. I said, Brian, me and you got to get together. I'm getting ready to retire, and my wife's got all this stuff she wants me to do. I'm gonna call Brian. I'm gonna call him. Say you can help fix me. Give me a good rate, whatever, we'll do it together. But you know, the thing is that people that love one another take care of one another. You take care of one another. I see people with small children that's got disabilities, wheelchairs, can't breathe, and they live to be 14 to 15 years old, and their parents have given everything they have to that child, and we know the child won't walk again. We know all the things, but they do it because of love. And if you don't love one another, life is not worth living. That's the way it goes. If you don't know Jesus, it's tough. Thank you for being here today for the family. Thank you for, if you haven't donated to the foundation that was listed in the obituary, think about that if you want to make a gift. And just do whatever you do because of love in your life. Don't do it for no reason of it. Don't do it because I'm here, anybody else. Do it because you loved her. And I know it's not the same as embracing her and loving her, but do things for one another. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love. We ask you to bless and be with us and strengthen us. And Lord, we ask you to be with us in such a way that only you can get the glory and the way. We thank you for loving us when we're not so lovable. We thank you for encouraging us when we're so discouraged. We thank you for friends that come and be with us from time to time that we hadn't counted on. We thank you for your handiwork in our parents. Lord, even though her parents are gone and most of her family is gone, her siblings, Lord, I just thank you for her. And Lord, with everything else, Lord, teach us to pray as you taught your disciples. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The postlude will be, It Is Well With My Soul.
And peace.
service will be concluded at the Alcorn Family Cemetery.